Capitalism and Democracy, and I'm going to tie it back to finance, you will see later on in the talk. The sort of starting point is clearly the crisis and the massive bailouts we've had. And around the world, you see technocratic governments, governments in Italy right now, previously in Greece, but also central banks, basically taking the burden of economic policies that are leading to recovery. It's no longer primarily the elected governments. Many of them seem in paralysis. The ECB, for example, is acting where the euro area cannot simply get that together. So technocratic governments and institutions taking up policy. Enormous levels of unemployment still, clearly long-term unemployment, both in the US as well as in Europe, are at very high levels, but also tremendous levels of youth unemployment. In this country, we have an ongoing foreclosure crisis. You're going to have a lot more in Europe, especially in Spain, as well as in some of the other countries which had booms like Ireland. And even while all this pain is being distributed, there is a sense that the 1% or the 0.1 or the 0.01% have received much of the gains in recent years, certainly in this country. Elsewhere, for example, India or China, there is a sense that there is the rise of oligarchies. Very extremely rich people and made rich often by access to natural resources and other sources of easy money. So the broad question that one can ask in this environment is, you know, have we got a situation where capitalists have captured policy? Are they inflicting their policies on the rest? And the kind of language that you hear often is this crisis is driven by policies by the elite, for the elite, and of the elite. For example, the whole move to liberalize the financial sector was elite-driven, and that created the problems that brought us here. And at the same time, one could ask, given that minimum wages haven't gone up significantly in real terms for the last so many years, given that unions are breaking down, is labor powerless? And finally, is democracy dead? You may have guessed the line I'm going to take, which is the answer to many of these questions is no. But there is a more, important threat to our market democratic economies, market-driven democratic economies. So let me start first with what I'm going to say here. I'm going to argue that the crisis was not caused by elitist, pro-elite or pro-corporate policies. We had more macro or populist underpinnings. I'm going to talk about those in a little more detail in a short while. But the elite are in disrepute because the pain has been felt largely by the masses while the elite have escaped. One sort of simple example of that is BMW sales in the United States this year, or I should say last year, were at their highest ever. So even while you have tons of unemployed, the elite seem to be doing fine. I would argue later on in the talk, not because of pro-elite policies, but because of the way technology and globalization have developed. In the meantime, we also have the necessity of having to violate a variety of property rights which have been established over time. And here I'm talking not just of physical property rights, not just of financial investments, but also of long-term entitlements, things like pensions, things like healthcare, which will have to be violated. And even while we violate them, it is likely that we would protect financial property rights a lot better. And it would seem again as if the property of the elite has been protected, while the property of the masses has been violated. So in this environment, it is very likely going forward, already you see signs in Greece and Spain, that popular perceptions will go against the elite. And if we go against the elite, I would argue that it's not just capitalism which is in trouble, but democracy also, which is in trouble. And I would argue there are things which we can do which are very strong. And in order to keep both strong, in order to preserve the market democracies that we have across the industrial world, we will, in many ways, have to restore opportunity to the middle class, opportunity and faith in the system to the middle class, faith that has been eroded over time. And to some extent, the other question is, can we do this without massive intervention? I hope we can, but I will argue the answer is not completely clear. So that's where I'm going. Let me start first with the macro underpinnings of the crisis and move quickly on to some of the financial, some of the bearing of finance. What you had post-war in the industrial world, in Europe, in the United States, was extremely strong growth. Growth was especially pronounced in Europe because it involved a lot of post-war reconstruction. Remember, Germany was in trouble, UK was in trouble, France was destroyed by the war passing through it. So reconstruction helped growth. But in addition, there were a number of low-hanging fruit which were plucked post-war. One was, as you remember, during the Depression, trade was totally repressed by acts like Smoot-Hawley in the United States and elsewhere. So just bringing down the protectionist barriers, resuming trade, led to more growth. Also, we had the spread of new technologies. In the age of the internet, some of you may believe that this is the age of new technologies. We didn't have so much innovation, so much change before. But if you think of our grandparents who saw the advent of electricity, grandparents who saw the arrival of the motor car, that was tremendous change, far more important in some ways than the social media and the internet we see today. But what happened post-World War II was the rollout of these technologies, electrification of towns, villages, the rollout for example, the use of motor cars and motorized vehicles for transport. That sort of reached all parts of the industrial world, and that also added to growth for quite some time. And finally, the spread of education. Education improved across the industrial world again post-World War. And so you see the relative rates of growth in the period 1950 to 73, 4.77% in Europe, 2.5% in the US, tremendous rates of growth, which hadn't been seen before. And in this period of very strong growth, there's lots of money to share. And there was share. Labor did quite well, there was labor peace. But also, in this period when growth seemed endless, a lot of promises were made. The welfare state, as we know it, was created in the 60s, largely to buy off groups that were getting anxious, they weren't sharing in. And promises were made as if growth wouldn't end. From worse, growth eventually ended. It ended in the early 70s as all these low-hanging fruits sort of were plucked. And we had stagflation in the 70s, especially with the increase in oil prices. So you have a world which suddenly the easy sources of growth have disappeared. The only way you can get strong, continued growth is total fractal productivity growth. That, as you know, to confront your TFP growth is hard because you have to be innovative, you have to create better, cleverer ways of doing things. You know, industrial economies basically slowed at that point. And in the United States and the United Kingdom, people started sort of wondering how to get out of this. And one set of solutions provided by Ronald Reagan and Margaret Thatcher was deregulation. We have constrained the economy too much post-depression. We have too little competition in many areas, the airlines, trucking, and so on. Let's deregulate. And as we deregulate, competition will force firms to become more efficient. That greater efficiency will increase productivity, and that productivity will lead to growth. So that was the solution in the UK, in the United States, and it worked. There was much greater competition, much greater growth. But in continental Europe, the sense that there's a need to deregulate was more muted. They liked the way of life they had. And instead, the way they tried to grow was through greater integration, creating a greater European market, the European common market initially, and eventually leading to open borders to labor, and finally, in 1999, the euro, which is a common currency. So let me take these two separately and talk a little bit about what I think happened. With the deregulation, you had tremendous increases in competition, and obviously lots of increase in returns to the innovators, the skilled and the creative. Now, when you also accompany it by financial sector deregulation, which we had lots of during this time, you increase the returns to talented human capital and versus the returns to physical or financial capital. So to look at this graph from Philippon and Rechev on the relative wages in the financial sector compared to the relative education. What you see here is as the financial sector was deregulated in the early 20s, the financial sector attracted the smartest and the most educated in the economy. So relative education in the financial sector was high. Wages in the financial sector were also commensurately high. Then you had the regulation in the 30s, which essentially shrank the opportunities in the financial sector. And you see the financial sector essentially coming down in terms of relative education, and I would argue also possibly relative skills and talent. And the financial sector is like every other sector in the early 1970s. Then you get deregulation again in the 1980s, and again the wages and the relative education in the financial sector climb relative to other sectors of the economy. And as we see nowadays, it's again shifting the other way as we get more regulation and as we get constraints and failures on the financial sector. There is a tongue-in-cheek article in the New York Times maybe two or 3 years ago, which suggests this kind of graph explains why we have a financial crisis by a economist called Calvin Trilling. And what he says is during the period of the 60s and the 70s, it was the C graders in class who went into the financial sector of Wall Street. They basically knew how to shake hands, to slap backs and play golf. And they made it into the financial firms where relationships were all that mattered. You didn't really need to know anything particularly deep. In the 1980s, we had the advent of the PhDs into the financial markets. And it turns out, according to Calvin Trilling, unfortunately the backslappers, the C-graders of the class, were at the top of the firms then when the smart young kids, the PhDs, came in and were in the trading rooms at that point. And so he argues the financial crisis was because there's a mismatch in power between the guys at the top who didn't understand anything about what the guys at the bottom were doing because there's a mismatch in intellectual capacity. Now, that's a tongue-in-cheek explanation of the crisis. I don't think it's true, partly because many of the guys at the top of these firms in 2007, 2008 were people who had come in post-1980. But nevertheless, the point is that the financial sector did attract the best and brightest. And of course, people, some whom are in this room, have written about why that was potentially a waste of talent, and others say that's a wonderful use of talent because the financial sector is the brains of the economy. Nevertheless, the point I want to make with that graph is that as you deregulate, as you get more competition, what you also have is growing inequality in incomes. Because talent will get more of the incomes, especially in a world where you have technology and globalization making it more of a superstar economy. So what are the effects, the additional effects of technology and globalization? I want to argue they are quite important to take note of. Take this 2x2 graph, which represents on the y-axis unskilled jobs and skilled jobs, on the x-axis routine jobs and non-routine jobs. If you think about the jobs that have disappeared in industrial countries, they're typically routine jobs, both skilled jobs and unskilled jobs. So take the clerk in an insurance company who was basically filling in a ledger and making simple calculations on the left-hand and right-hand side of the ledger. That requires some education. high school education, sometimes basic university education. That job is gone, replaced by a computer. If you take the left-hand bottom graph, the routine unskilled jobs, you know, the textile worker, every country that has grown has started by first entering the textile industry. Happened in Japan, moved on to Korea, moved on to China, now going on to Vietnam and Cambodia. This is the Donald Fisher Sellingson sort of model, where the low end is occupied by the countries that are trying to grow. And those jobs went a long back from the industrial countries, outsourced to the rest of the world. So what we're left with are two sets of jobs. The non-routine creative jobs, the kind of jobs that everybody in this room does, where at least for now, it's very hard to replace you with a computer. And then there's non-routine unskilled jobs, job for gardener, which today again, are hard to replace that with a robot, the job of a house cleaner, the job of a hamburger flipper. These jobs are extremely hard as of now to replace with technology or outsource them to the rest of the world. So in a sense, the world is divided into, as a software entrepreneur told me, people who tell the computers what to do and people whom the computers tell what to do. So people at the top right are people who tell the computers what to do, and people in the bottom right are the people whom the computers tell what to do or you tell what to do. So there is a disparity. And the middle, which usually occupy the left top corner, is disappearing. You can see this in just the numbers, but the numbers themselves don't tell the full story, because you have to ask, well, if there is demand for the creative, why don't we produce more creative people? Why is the supply of creative people keeping pace? And that's where, certainly in the United States, you see that in the race between technology and education, basically education is falling behind. Technology, globalization are increasing the demand of highly skilled people, people you train. Unfortunately, the supply of those skilled people is not being paced. I mean, one amazing statistic is people aged 25 to 34 in the United States today are less likely to have a degree than people who are 45 to 54 years old. So even though the need for higher education is increasing, you see in more recent cohorts less higher education. The skill mismatch is most pronounced in males, which also speaks to potential social problems going forward, given the traditional concept of the household that we have, where typically in the past the male has been better educated than the female. Clearly we need social change to adapt to the fact that women are now much better educated and likely to hold much better jobs than men. And maybe that social change is much overdue. But in addition, there are other kinds of mismatches. For example, there's a great need for science, technology, engineering, math, the kinds of jobs that will be created in the United States. But too few people take those degrees in college. Even if you get a college degree, it doesn't necessarily mean you're assured of a job. We have too many people doing the liberal arts and too few people doing the hard sciences. And some of that, I would argue, is again because we haven't trained our children in the country to take these harder courses. My colleague, my friend at Purdue University tells me that they find they can't staff the courses in computer science. Many computer science professors are sent to sabbatical because they can't be fired, but they sent them for sabbaticals because there aren't enough students taking their classes. In a world where computer science is going to be one big sort of strong degree to have. And I asked him why. I mean, there is so much demand for these kinds of jobs. And he says the reason is too many of them flunk out the basic math course. And because they don't have basic math, they can't take computer science. And so that speaks to the fact that inadequacies in, way before university, in families, in communities, in preschool preparation, and the K-12 schooling experience, essentially ensuring we don't get adequate university graduates. My colleague at Chicago, Jim Hedman, basically argues by age 5 you're done. By age 5, you're fixed for life because you've had your nutrition, you've had your basic sort of discipline as a kid, and you've learned certain norms. And beyond that, it's very hard to remedy what damage has been done to you in further life. So there's a lot that needs to be done early on to fix the problems of inadequate skills in education in society. And starting at university is too late. Now we are seeing what's happening is to look at these two sets of graphs. The one on the left basically shows I can't see this graph from here. So I have to put on my specs. Okay. It shows the changes in employment by skill percentile. So more skill is to the right, less skill is to the left. And what you see is 1979-1989 in the United States, you see an increase in the employment of really skilled people, not so much in the unskilled people. This is as it should be for a developed country, the leading economy in the world. However, look beyond that to 1989-99 and 1999-2007. What you see is the increase in employment at the middle skills is very muted. It's the low end and the high end, both of which are growing, which sort of bears out the graph, the sort of 2x2 matrix I showed you. The middle is disappearing, both ends are increasing. And that's true again of the wages. Again, earlier on, the wage increases at the top exceeded the wage increases at the bottom. We should expect that in a world where technology is increasing the demand for skills. But increasingly what we're seeing is now both ends are going up while the middle is going down. This the light green line on the right hand side is also the famous sort of decline in median wage issue. Median wages haven't increased in the United States over the last decade. So you have a stagnating middle, and this is one more graph making the same point. The darker line is the 1950 income differential. That is the growth in incomes of the 90th percentile of the wage distribution relative to the 50th. And you can see that that has been growing substantially in the United States, while the 50-10 has not. The 1950 income distribution, income differential is between a graduate, typically a manager at a Walmart, and a factory worker who's a high school graduate. So that reflects the education premium or skill premium. While between the 50th and the 10th percentile, both are essentially people who aren't graduates, the 10th percentile may be a dropout, the 50th percentile may have a high school degree, but that wage differential hasn't moved. In fact, it's been fairly flat for the last so many years. So what I think all these graphs suggest is there is a problem. As you liberalize, as you get the benefits of technology, as you get the benefits of globalization, it's very important that education keep pace, that skill building keep pace, so that your economy moves up. For a variety of reasons, it hasn't happened in the United States, and therefore, increasingly, people at the top get a bigger share of the income, and people in the middle are shut out. And you still need people at the bottom to do some of the non-routine, unskilled work. So given that the top is running away, and this here, we're not talking about the top 1%. We're talking about everybody in this school. We're talking about everybody who has a degree is basically running away from the middle. It's not the top 1% or the top 0.01%. It's a deeper problem than that, and it's a much more obvious problem. So I would argue that this creates problems. It's also, there are silver linings in what is happening. The one I've already mentioned, women are coming up relative to men. Certainly in this country, they seem to have a better ability to absorb education. But also, there is the fact that the new elite is based much more on educational attainments and capabilities and possibly luck than primarily race, gender, or even university. There's a very nice paper by Peter Capelli of Wharton, along with co-authors, which shows that CEO backgrounds have moved from being largely ideally placed to being much more broad-based, and at the same time, as the tenure has come down upon the many corporate finance have made. Nevertheless, even though your achievements matter much more, and your capabilities matter much more than who you are and where you were born, there is increasing entrenchment once again. But this is not based on caste or creed. It's increasingly based on whether your parents are rich. The children of rich parents are much more likely to complete college than the children of poor parents, and the difference is increasing. But it's not just your ability to complete college. In this fascinating book by Charles Murray, Growing Apart, he shows along every dimension that you might possibly care about. Divorce rates, health, crime rates. The rich are growing apart from the poor in very important ways. So there is a real problem, and I would argue that the politicians move to address that. As more and more Americans are left behind in perception, if not in fact, increasing polarization in society, there's a lot of pressure upon people to do something. But education is very difficult to tackle. I would argue that every American president since Gerald Ford, including the two presidential contenders today, have argued they are for education. They are going to be the education president. Of course, nothing really it's very hard to declare success. Much has happened. It's very hard to declare success because education is really, really difficult to change fundamentally. So what do you do when you have a large segment of population, middle class, falling behind and getting more aggrieved? Very hard to reach redistribution, because remember, we're going through the Reagan era, we're going through the Clinton era. There is a lot of resentment against the welfare fringe and political support across the spectrum to do something about that. So you have people falling behind, but redistribution is hard. What do you do? You realize if you're a politician that people care about consumption. And so what if they don't have income growth? If you can manufacture consumption, they feel happy and they support you. How do you get consumption without income growth? And the answer is credit. If you can make credit easier, if you can allow them to borrow in a way that they don't feel they're borrowing themselves into debt, fantastic. You've got a machine which makes everybody happy. And I would argue that basic machine was housing credit. You borrow, but you borrowed against home equity because your house price went up. The house price went up, you didn't feel that you were borrowing yourself into penury. You could tap into your house ATM and take out the money. It made everybody happy. It made the people happy, it made the bankers happy, it made the politicians happy. Maybe a few regulators asked questions, but they were quickly hammered back. With arguments about how you didn't want to interrupt this process of the spread of home ownership. If you look across the political spectrum, people now who are railing against the financial sector were in the vanguard to open and cut ribbons, opening up new low-income housing to people, and saying, standing along with the bankers who finance that housing and saying how wonderful it is that people can get houses. From the Clinton administration, this was affordable housing. There was a massive push to ensure that it happened via agencies like the FHA, Fannie and Freddie. And the Bush administration, believing that people who owned homes, property owners, were more likely to be a Republican, also pushed in the same direction. And you had Bush's Ownership Society pushing the same policies that the Clinton administration pushed. Bipartisan support for easy credit, broad spread home ownership. That was the kind of environment in which you had the housing crisis build up. You don't need to argue that it was Fannie and Freddie who did it. That's not a necessary argument. All you have to understand is right now we feel so aggrieved against the financials when we want to pelt the bankers with tomatoes. We were all very supportive at that time, because it seemed like the answer to many of our problems. If you look at inequality, you see inequality in incomes, that's the red line between the 90th and the 10th percentile, increasing tremendously over this period. Look at inequality in consumption, which is the blue line. between the 90th and 10% are not increasing at all. My colleagues, Marion Bertrand and Adair Morse, have also looked into this across small areas within the United States. And the research showed that in the areas that had more inequality, income inequality, you actually see much more spending by people at the bottom. They're trying to, in a sense, keep up with the Joneses. And you also find in those areas much more credit and eventually much greater financial pain for their financial discourse in those areas. They also find that politicians in those areas tended to support legislation which tended to expand credit to low-income segments of the population. So the line I'm trying to draw is between low growth, deregulation, greater inequality, and financial excess. That line doesn't need to be a continuous line. It could have been interrupted. And it's not saying that deregulation was a bad thing. Deregulation in many ways helped. The Walmart effect that people talk about, the fact that the poor can now consume much more because they can get much cheaper prices at the Walmart. That itself have been an enormous benefit because it would have increased real wages and something like that. Despite the relatively lower wages of the middle, because of the greater consumption we can buy today with those wages, they're actually better off. But nevertheless, the point I want to make is, if the deregulation had been accompanied by better education, better skilled living, we would not have to be in this situation today. Financial deregulation helped. It helped innovation. But financial innovation also went off track in an environment where it was seen as the answer to a more intractable problem, how to build skills in the economy. And so at this point, when the financial sector across the world has gone off track, there's this very real question being posed by people like Paul Krugman: should we make finance boring again? Put finance back into a box. Shut it up with regulation. Maybe even over-regulation, why not? Let's bring Glass-Steagall, let's bring the whole crew, let's bring everything we can to try and get mainstream banking in, make finance boring. I would argue that is the wrong answer. We are too advanced as an economy to actually have that kind of finance again. The age of boosters instead of interest rates is past. You cannot go back to it. We need finance to function as the brains of the economy. But for that, we also need to tame its excesses. And how to do that is something that is work in progress. I don't think we know. I don't think we're still coming to grips with why finance went off track. I have suggested one broad macro phenomenon, which is lots of people were very happy that it went in the direction it went. But we need a better understanding of issues like liquidity, of financial frictions and financial intermediation, to understand how exactly we can get the benefits of finance without the cost. And I would argue that, to my mind, is the only solution. We cannot make finance boring again. Let me turn finally to the euro area before I conclude. Remember, the euro area did go through the process of deregulation early on as a way to growth. It did deregulate. This is not to say it didn't. But it saw integration as the way to succeed rather than deregulation. So building a bigger common European market, building a common European financial system. And the point, however, was it was in some ways, they didn't tackle the real issues, such as the fact that they were highly regulated, and they were economies which had problems even before the euro area accession. For example, in Southern Europe, you had what were insider-outsider economies. If you were an insider, you had a job, you did very well, because your benefits were large, you retired early, it was all very well protected. If you're an outsider, one of the youth in those countries at that time, too bad, you were shut out until after many years of waiting outside, you were admitted to the inner chambers. So there was high unemployment even before euro accession. There was relatively low growth. Euro area was growing at 1.5% at that time. And there were big problems in the euro area. People sort of think the euro area had problems only after the recent crisis. No, before they entered the euro area, they had problems. They thought the euro was the answer. And for a short while it was an answer, because of the same sort of phenomena that we saw in the United States. Easy access to finance, expanded spending tremendously. In Greece it was spending on government, government expanded. Friends and relatives of the party in power got jobs. Lots of government jobs created. In Spain it was construction. Whether it was construction financed by the local governments or financed by household housing spending. And across the board, massive increases in government spending financed by issuance of government debt. Even though, you know, some people argue, well, Spain didn't spend too much, look, it had low levels of government debt. If you look at the right way of seeing these things, the fact that there's a boom, therefore government revenues were large, they should have been saved for the bad times. The cyclically adjusted government spending went out of bounds for almost every country in Europe, except Germany. So, as a result of all the spending, especially spending on non-traded sectors like construction, like government, you increase wages in the economy. You increase wages in the economy beyond the level at which the economy was competitive, and as a result, post-crisis, you find that Spain, Portugal, Greece are all highly uncompetitive. You would think for a country in crisis, you go there, haircuts would be cheap, restaurants would be cheap. They're not. They're still very expensive, partly a function of this lack of uncompetitiveness. So what has happened in Spain, Greece, Italy, is very similar to what happened in the United States in areas that have had a boom. Pre-boom, big problems. Boom, took care of those problems, and then bust, problems are back. High levels of unemployment. It's true of the United States also. The United States, a number of areas have been suffering a decline because of the fall in manufacturing for the reasons I talked about, the loss of manufacturing jobs, a typical middle-class job. Those jobs were temporarily replaced by construction jobs during the boom. And for a while, those areas got very happy, spent a lot, and then get the bust, and if you trace out the line of job losses, it's back as if there's no disruption as a result of construction. Tremendous job losses to make up for the time when the construction boom. So, to answer the question that I started out with, have capitalists subverted democracy, have they subverted democracy? I would argue to look at the details of what happened. It's not pro-elite policies, it's more populist policies, more broad-based policies, which was nearly benefited by, but which were largely directed at the masses. That created the problems we were in, whether in the euro area or the United States. We had unsustainable solutions provided by easy credit and resulting government or household spending. Now, this is not to hold private financiers to blame. I think they were fully complicit. There was, we are seeing evidence of criminal activity, whether it's manipulating LIBOR or in some of the mortgage selling. But to argue that this was the source of the problem, I think, is overstating the role of finance. Finance is sort of the animator, is a willing accomplice, but is not the prime mover. The prime mover were bigger political forces. And there was a convergence between business and politics across the world to use finance for these ends. And you know, one way of seeing this is long before the crisis, you see public debt in industrial countries, like the graph on the right-hand side, building up way before the crisis. The crisis just accentuated the buildup of public debt. But this whole incentive to borrow and spend and to grow as a result was there long before. So to blame this on pro-elite policies is, I think, in this reading. Now, post-crash, one could ask the same question, have the policies been pro-elite post-crash? And, you know, you could argue that the bank bailouts would have been harsher on the banks and bank shareholders and bondholders. You could have imposed dividend restrictions earlier. You could have forced the banks to raise capital rather than deleverage by shrinking assets and lending. You could have asked them to have a moratorium on bonuses. In general, very little of this was done post-crisis, which gave the banks a bad name as they got back into demanding bonuses soon after the crisis, even while there were high levels of unemployment. So, the resolution was perhaps not as harsh as it should have been. However, I do think, as somebody who specializes in banking, that the resolution was necessary. Just saying, let the chips fall where they will, and let the banking sector go to hell if necessary, we'll build up a new one afterwards, as some of my more right-wing colleagues think, I think that would be a mistake, because institutional sort of reconstruction is much harder and takes much longer. We would have the Great Depression all over again than the banks failed. However, we could have been harsher, and especially because the political fallout of not being so harsh, the fact that TARP was seen as something terrible rather than a success, also creates problems going forward. Because given the state of the country's finances, and this is independent of the crisis, this problem would exist regardless of the crisis, the promises that were made in the 60s, which are now coming to hit us, are unaffordable. We cannot pay the pensions that have been promised. We cannot pay the healthcare that has been promised. But you are now having to renegotiate this, even while at the first pass you have protected the shares and the bonds of the holders of bank securities. And going forward, you're going to find it very hard to renegotiate state debt or the federal debt. Those are things that you're unlikely to touch. And therefore, if you're touching pensions, you're touching social security, you're violating those property rights, but you're enforcing the bondholder rights, you're enforcing, you're protecting the rights of shareholders, even though they have no rights. That differential enforcement of property rights is also going to raise enormous questions. So, you could very well ask whether the technocratic governments are really in place to violate these property rights because the politicians won't do it directly, given the problem they face. But I would argue, to sum up, there is a growing tension between democracy and free enterprise post-crisis. The first is, everything that we talk about, and I think most people in this room would agree with me that free enterprise is generally a good thing. Free enterprise makes sense when everybody sort of has an opportunity to take advantage of it. If, however, free enterprise benefits one segment of the population but not another, there is a tremendous resistance to the kinds of laws and legislation that support property and free enterprise. Second, we are going to see going forward, given where we are, a selective enforcement of property rights. We don't start explaining why the bondholder deserves to be protected more than the pension holder. And that's a reality that many states in the United States will soon have to face, that they will service their debt while they will violate the pension claims that they promised all too often to public sector workers. You will have problems. Because the public will not see why the selective enforcement. So that itself will create some problems going forward. You already see the fallout in countries like Greece and Spain. But I think there's an equally deep problem, which is having capitalists, property owners, small enterprise, medium enterprise, large enterprise, who are seen as legitimate, is extremely important to keep a constraint on arbitrary government. And this is where I think capitalism serves the interests of democracy. Why? If you look across the world, there are very few capitalist societies that are not democratic and democratic societies that are not capitalist. I think there is a synergy between the two. And one example of a situation where it breaks down is Russia under Putin. Why is it that the oligarchs, somebody like Khodorkovsky was so easily sent to jail and so easily put away for a long time. I think the reason why his property didn't protect him was because it was seen as illegitimate by the public. Many Russians applauded when he was put in jail because they believed many of the oligarchs stole the property they came by. So when property is seen as illegitimate, a consequence of, say, things like the bank crisis where bankers are seen as illegitimate capitalists. If that expands and property more generally is seen as illegitimate, it removes a constraint on government. People outside government who have property, the Sheldon Adelsons of the world, play a role because they serve as a constraint on arbitrary government. But to the extent that they owe their property to government, they have a tendency then to join hands with the government and make it much more powerful and much more anti-people than necessarily it could be. And you only have to look at Russia, and to some extent China has to break away from this to become more democratic and eventually more capitalist. So, broadly speaking, we need to restore opportunity and hope for the middle class. That is the way we can preserve capitalism and a strong democracy. Democracies have turned before. You only have to remember what happened in Germany in the 20s and the early 30s with the Weimar Republic. The middle class demolished because high inflation essentially eroded their wealth. The middle class very angry and looking for solutions which eventually Hitler provided. That's not where we want to go. I'm not suggesting that's where we are, but that's what happens as you erode the opportunities and hope for the middle class. So I think the policies that we need are policies like improved education and skill building, while also preserving innovation, which creates new jobs, which potentially the middle class can do. I think we need to preserve that. But these will take time. And in the short run, there are massive problems we need to deal with. How do you deal with the unemployed, especially the youth? How do you get them into the labor force? How do you retrain those in sunset industries? What do you say to the 57-year-old GM worker who's been fired and hasn't found a job for 2 years? How do you engage the unemployable? We keep thinking everybody is employable, but there are some people who are unemployable. How do you re-engage them in new kinds of work that they can do? And finally, how do you get the working rich? How do you get them to pay for it? This is perhaps the first time in history where people who are rich work much harder than people who are poor. The people who are rich are often consultants, lawyers, academics, working 70, 80 hour weeks. The factory worker goes home after 50 hours, back really working, no doubt, but the people at the top working much longer hours, they feel they've earned the money. They're not the average. Why should they give it away? And so the polarization in society between those who need the money and those who make the money is increasing. We also have to make decisions on property. What do we default on and how do we explain it to the people? How do we explain that the debt holder, his property is worth protecting, while the pensioner, his property can be violated? So to end, our problems are not, in my view, a deep capture. Not anymore than in the past. I'm not naively saying there's no crony capitalism, there's no bribery at the top, there aren't industries that are paid off politicians, money has no influence. The evidence is there. Money is making its way in big time into politics. All I'm saying is there's enough competition there that things aren't much worse than they were before. Even Citizens United in the United States, which allows large organizations to put money into the political process, you have large organizations on the left as well as large organizations on the right. For every corporation, you have a union. And they're both active at this point. So I'm not sure that that has changed the balance of power. And of course, with all these new social media, even the smallest, my son can blog and can send out his political views to whoever cares to read them. So I think this, I don't argue, I don't want to argue that we have more elite capture than in the past, I think maybe even less. But I do think that the problems industrial democracies have are very real, very serious, and look as if they have been captured by the elite. I think they have to restore growth. That is the fundamental problem. And restoring growth means focusing on things like innovation, focusing on things like skill building, but these take time. And time is not what politicians have. They typically respond with short-term policies, and what we see with the crisis is these policies can make things worse and restore and reduce support for free enterprise. So, I would argue there is a real threat to democracy. There is a real threat to capitalism. The real threat to democracy is the fact that there's a threat to capitalism. And we need to restore faith in capitalism more broadly, which means do the things, not cosmetic, to do the real things that give the middle class hope, because the alternative could be much more disastrous. So that, let me stop. And I'll stay away.